don't be afraid. Max Lucado calls us to courage in this audio presentation of his book, Fearless, Imagine Your Life Without Fear, read by Daniel Butler.
Chapter 1. They're talking layoffs at work, slowdowns in the economy, flare-ups in the Middle East, turnovers at headquarters, downturns in the housing market, upswings in global warming, breakouts of Al-Qaeda cells. Some demented dictators collecting nuclear warheads the way others collect fine wines. A strain of Asian flu is boarding flights out of China. The plague of our day, terrorism, begins with the word terror. We fear being sued, finishing last, going broke. We fear the mole on the back, the new kid on the block, the sound of the clock as it ticks us closer to the grave. We sophisticate investment plans, create elaborate security systems, and legislate stronger military, yet we depend on mood-altering drugs more than any other generation in history. Moreover, the average child today has the same level of anxiety as the average psychiatric patient in the 1950s. Fear, it seems, has taken a 100-year lease on the building next door and set up shop. Oversized and rude, fear is unwilling to share the heart with happiness. Happiness complies. Do you ever see the two together? Can one be happy and afraid at the same time? Clear thinking and afraid, confident and afraid, merciful and afraid? No. Fear is the big bully in the high school hallway, brash, loud, and unproductive. For all the noise fear makes and room it takes, fear does little good. Fear never wrote a symphony or poem, negotiated a peace treaty, or cured a disease. Fear never pulled a family out of poverty or a country out of bigotry. Fear never saved a marriage or a business. Courage did that. Faith did that. People who refused to consult or cower to their timidities did that. But fear itself? Fear herds us into a prison and slams the doors. Wouldn't it be great to walk out? Imagine your life wholly untouched by angst. What if faith, not fear, was your default reaction to threats? If you could hover a fear magnet over your heart and extract every last shaving of dread, insecurity, and doubt, what would remain? Envision a day, just one day, absent the dread of failure, rejection, and calamity. Can you imagine a life with no fear? This is the possibility behind Jesus' question, why are you afraid? At first blush, we wonder if Jesus is serious. He may be kidding, teasing, pulling a quick one. Kind of like one swimmer asking another, why are you wet? But Jesus doesn't smile. He's dead earnest. So are the men to whom he asked the question. A storm has turned their Galilean dinner cruise into a white-knuckled plunge. Here's how one of them remembered the trip. Jesus got into a boat, and his followers went with him. A great storm arose on the lake so that waves covered the boat. These are Matthew's words. He remembered well the pouncing tempest and bouncing boat and was careful in his terminology. Not just any noun would do. He pulled his Greek thesaurus off the shelf and hunted for a descriptor that exploded like the waves across the bow. He bypassed common terms for spring shower, squall, cloudburst, or downpour. They didn't capture what he felt and saw that night. A rumbling earth and quivering shoreline. He recalled more than Winds and Whitecaps. His fingers followed the column of synonyms down, down until he landed on a word that worked. Ah, there it is. Seismos. A quake. A trembling eruption of sea and sky. A great seismos arose on the lake. The term still occupies a spot in our vernacular. A seismologist studies earthquakes. A seismograph measures them. And Matthew, along with a crew of recent recruits, felt a seismos that shook them to the core. He used the word on only two other occasions. Once at Jesus' death, when Calvary shook, and again at Jesus' resurrection, when the graveyard tremored. Apparently, the stilled storm shares equal billing in the trilogy of Jesus' great shake-ups, defeating sin on the cross, death at the tomb, and here, silencing fear on the sea. Sudden fear. We know the fear was sudden because the storm was. An older translation reads, "Suddenly a great tempest arose on the sea." Not all storms come suddenly. Prairie farmers can see the formation of thunderclouds hours before the rain falls. This storm, however, springs like a lion out of the grass. One minute, the disciples are shuffling cards for a mid-journey game of hearts. The next, they're gulping Galilean sea spray. Peter and John, seasoned sailors, struggle to keep down the sail. Matthew, confirmed landlubber, struggles to keep down his breakfast. The storm is not what the tax collector bargained for. Do you sense his surprise in the way he links his two sentences? Jesus got into a boat, and his followers went with him. A great storm arose on the lake. Wouldn't you hope for a more chipper second sentence, a happier consequence of obedience? Jesus got into a boat, his followers went with him, and suddenly a great rainbow arched in the sky. A flock of doves hovered in happy formation. A sea of glass mirrored their mast. Don't Christ followers enjoy a calendar full of Caribbean cruises? No. This story sends the not-so-subtle and not-too-popular reminder, getting on board with Christ can mean getting soaked with Christ. Disciples can expect rough seas and stout winds. In the world, you will, not might, may, or could, have tribulation. Christ followers contract malaria, bury children, and battle addictions, and as a result, face fears. It's not the absence of storms that sets us apart. It's whom we discover in the storm, an unstirred Christ. Jesus was sleeping, the gospel records. Now there's a scene. The disciples scream, Jesus dreams. Thunder roars, Jesus snores. He doesn't doze, catnap, or rest. He slumbers. Could you sleep at a time like this? Could you snooze during a roller coaster loop-de-loop? In a wind tunnel? At a kettle drum concert? Jesus sleeps through all three at once. Mark's gospel adds two curious details. Jesus was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. In the stern on a pillow. Why the first? From whence came the second? First century fishermen used large, heavy seine nets for their work. They stored the nets in a nook that was built into the stern for this purpose. Sleeping upon the stern deck was impractical. It provided no space or protection. The small compartment beneath the stern, however, provided both. It was the most enclosed and only protected part of the boat, so Christ, a bit dozy from the day's activities, crawled beneath the deck to get some sleep. He rested his head not on a fluffy feather pillow, but on a leather sandbag, a ballast bag. Mediterranean fishermen still use them. They weigh about 100 pounds and are used to ballast or stabilize the boat. Did Jesus take the pillow to the stern so he could sleep, or sleep so soundly that someone rustled him up the pillow? We don't know. But this much we do know. This was a premeditated slumber. He didn't accidentally nod off. In full knowledge of the coming storm, Jesus decided it was siesta time. So he crawled into the corner, put his head on the pillow, and drifted into dreamland. His snooze troubles the disciples. Matthew and Mark record their responses as 3 staccato Greek pronouncements and 1 question. The pronouncements, "Lord, save, dying." The question, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" They do not ask about Jesus' strength. Can you still the storm? His knowledge? Are you aware of the storm? Or his know-how? Do you have any experience with storms? But rather, they raise doubts about Jesus' character. Do you not care? Fear does this. Fear corrodes our confidence in God's goodness. We begin to wonder if love lives in heaven, if God can sleep in our storms, if his eyes stay shut when our eyes grow wide, if he permits storms after we get on his boat. Does he care? Fear unleashes a swarm of doubts, anger-stirring doubts. The disciples had reason to trust Jesus. By now, they'd seen him healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. They had witnessed him heal a leper with a touch and a servant with a command. Peter saw his sick mother-in-law recover, and they all saw demons scatter like bats out of a cave. He cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. Shouldn't someone mention Jesus' track record or review his resume? Do they remember the accomplishments of Christ? They may not. Fear creates a form of spiritual amnesia. It dulls our miracle memory. It makes us forget what Jesus has done and how good God is. And fear feels dreadful. It sucks the life out of the soul, curls us into an embryonic state, and drains us dry of contentment. We become abandoned barns, rickety and tilting from the winds, a place where humanity used to eat, thrive, and find warmth. No longer. When fear shapes our lives, safety becomes our God. When safety becomes our God, we worship the risk-free life. Can the safety lover do anything great? Can the risk-averse accomplish noble deeds? For God? For others? No. The fear-filled cannot love deeply. Love is risky. They cannot give to the poor. Benevolence has no guarantee of return. The fear-filled cannot dream wildly. What if their dreams sputter and fall from the sky? The worship of safety emasculates greatness. No wonder Jesus wages such a war against fear. His most common command emerges from the fear not genre. The Gospels list some 125.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.